Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for coming. The Baltimore Architecture Foundation is very happy and proud to present this event this year, as well as the whole series of events. The mission of the Baltimore Architecture Foundation is to celebrate design and the built environment. The BAF encourages people to explore Baltimore's architecture and design, to be mindful of the area's history, recognize its architectural heritage, and appreciates its designs and innovations. We're so happy again to be having this event this year, and we'd like to thank the entire committee for tirelessly planning this series of events. And I'd like to present now the co-chairs of the event, Randy Sovich and Kelly Dance. Thank you so much.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Randy Sovich, principal of R.M. Sovich Architecture and co-founder of the journal Texture. I'm co-chair of this year's lecture series with Kelly Barnes, who's here with me. She'll have a moment to speak as well. Oops, what did I just do? Oh, okay, good, wrong one. Texture is a little magazine inspired and humbled. One more. Okay. Inspired and humbled by the journals that sprung up early in the 20th century and again in the 1960s, such as Archigram. Texture began as a series of conversations that I had with co-founder Craig Purcell of BCT Architects. We discussed how new technologies have affected... It's right here. Why isn't it? Oh, there we go. We discussed how new technologies have affected architecture over our careers, and we discussed trends as we saw them. Neo-modernism is now a historical style that has become entrenched in the establishment. Fashions or techniques such as parametricism, tree-covered buildings, container architecture, glass facades, reflecting nature, resting facades, facades as doorways, and what we call house modern, expose the void inherent in the neo-modernist style. We believe these attempts to connect architecture and nature are the result of two or more generations of architects unschooled about the role and creation of ornament other than as an artifact of the past. We wondered, is ornament the missing element in contemporary architecture that would connect buildings to our place and time? Is texture the new ornament? Can texture and pattern replace ornament? How do we create an ornament for our time? The addition of Linda Burke to the editorial team gave us the expertise we needed to put together a credible publication. The first three issues of Texture explored texture, ornament, and pattern in architecture, and essays and projects from architects, artists, designers, and historians from around the globe. Each had as its centerpiece an interview or essay by an expert. As we planned issue four, we discussed the idea of edge with Professor Casey, who's speaking tonight. We then approached the AIA asking to create a symposium centered around the idea of edge and the harbor in order to literally bring the idea home to Baltimore. Kathleen and Suzanne were enthusiastic and instrumental in developing the idea from a symposium to this program, which you'll see tonight in the next few weeks, which will consist not of just lectures, but presentations and conversations pairing visiting and local speakers in conversation with the audience, and a competition, and an exhibition, and a publication, and more. This exciting series begins tonight with the Edge of Edge. The program lays the foundation for the series and design competition and the theme of the Edge, Harbor, and City. The program continues on March 27th with Engaging the Edge. Speakers at that program will discuss the visual and ecological grammar of the edge through means of ornamental and regenerative design. Speakers will be Kent Bloomer and Christopher Streb. Don't miss the event on April 24th, The Intentional and Unintentional Edge. The speakers will discuss design at the harbor and city edge in both planned and unplanned contexts. The speakers will be Daniel Campo of Morgan and Barbara Wilkes, first woman president of the Baltimore chapter of the AIA, will be returning to speak on that panel. We will want you to be here for May 1st for the presentation, The Edge of Experience. The speakers at this program will provide a dialogue into the philosophical and the inevitable, discussing how we experience design and how we can design for the future. The speakers will be Roger Terrell and Katie O'Meara. But there's more. On May 4th, we will have a harbor boat tour with local speakers discussing the history of the harbor. On May 8th, there will be a Neighborhood Design Center conversation at the Motor House. We will also have numerous brown bag lunch talks on the topic of the harbor. All of these things will be posted on the AI website, so please look for details. Kelly and I would like to thank... Now it's not going. Okay, hold on. I thought it was scrolling. I apologize, you were all supposed to flash before your eyes. How's modern? We would like to thank all of the people and organizations who have contributed financially to support the program of events, specifically the American Society of Landscape Architects, Lewis Contractors and Visit Baltimore, the Ionic and Doric sponsors, and we also want to thank everyone on the Lecture Series Committee. Everyone on the Lecture Series Committee who participated, and to thank everyone who contributed by meeting with us, talking to us, sharing their thoughts on a personal note. I would like to recognize Kelly Danz and Eric Shore for their dedication in getting all the moving parts of this program working. And now Kelly will talk.
I'm Kelly. I'm an architect and I work at Roar Studio. I'm the co-chair with Randy, and I'm going to introduce the design competition. This year we are holding the first ever design competition in conjunction with the lecture series. The ALA Baltimore and our Baltimore Architecture Foundation lecture series partnership with Texture Journal this year that Randy described has created a unique opportunity for design competition. Our thought was to address the topics in the lecture programs through our way of communication, design, and document the design ideas in the publication. We are asking design professionals in the region for speculations on what the Baltimore Harbor and City Edge could be. We are asking you to reflect on, illustrate, define, and/or redefine edges, and to consider the following prompts. If the harbor water is swimmable and fishable, what could the harbor edge look like? How can we address spatial equity and create a harbor accessible to all residents of Baltimore? What is the harbor edge of Baltimore? Should it be hard? Should it be soft? Permeable? These questions, among others, in the competition brief are to serve as guides for design concepts. The competition is purposefully open-ended in terms of program, scale, etc., to keep it unrestricted for the individual interests of each design team. So get together with your coworkers and your colleagues to flex your design muscles. We encourage teams to be multidisciplinary. We are challenging you to harness your creativity and vision for the future of Baltimore. What design intervention would you create that addresses the harbor and city edge in Baltimore? The registration deadline is April 3rd, and the competition submission deadline is May 24th. Submitted work will be reviewed by a jury consisting of the creators of Texture, this year's lecture series speakers, and committee members. Work that is selected will be published in this year's edition of Texture and will be featured in an exhibition this fall. The design competition details, resources, and registration can be found online at aiabaltimore.org, and we hope that you will participate. We can't wait to see your work. It is our goal that the lecture series this year will bring a range of perspectives to focus on the Baltimore Harbor and City Edge, that the lecture content will inform the design proposals entering the competition, and that these ideas will inspire real-world action. So we hope that you will continue to attend the lecture series this year and that you enter the competition. And now, it is my pleasure to introduce the moderator of tonight's lecture panel. Julio Benitez directs the Cultural Studies and Sacred Space Graduate Concentration Program at the Catholic University of America School of Architecture and Planning. He holds a Master of Architecture. He holds a Master of Architecture and a PhD in Education degrees from the University of Minnesota. He has been teaching architectural design, communication, and theory for 30 years. Dr. Bermudez's teaching and research are focused on the architectural phenomenology and the relationship between architecture, culture, and spirituality. He has lectured, led symposia, and published articles in these areas nationally and internationally. Current projects include a neuroscience study of architecturally induced contemplative states and work on a book manuscript on the architectural extraordinary. He has published two books, Architecture, Culture, and Spirituality, and Transcending Architecture, Contemporary Views on Sacred Space. In 2007, Dr. Bermudez co-founded the Architecture, Culture, and Spirituality Forum, an organization with over 500 members from 48 countries, and he has served as its president since 2015. We are very excited to have him moderate tonight's panel. Welcome, Julio.
thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Kelly. Thank you, Randy. And thank you, Kathleen, for organizing the symposium or this talk and inviting me to moderate it. Let me just say a couple things to organize what's happening tonight. Maybe you repeat a little bit. We're going to have three panelists that I will introduce after I just give a short overview of phenomenology and architecture, as you can see there. Each one will have about 15 minutes to make their point. Then we're going to see there and open for conversation and with hopefully input from the public, from you. So so let me first do my part here, which is basically talk a little bit about architecture and phenomenology. And the reason for this is because one of our speakers, philosopher Ed Casey, his work is all around this very topic, phenomenology. And we thought that perhaps somebody need to say a few things about it. So I'm going to go into it if you don't mind. Phenomenology is a branch of philosophy that considers our human experience as its area of study. The argument is as simple, at least for me, as compelling. If you truly pay attention to what is happening right now, for instance, what you're conscious of at any moment, you would have to conclude that the only thing you could say for sure is that consciousness is that experience that is at hand, in your mind, in your emotions, in your senses. In a way, you could say experience is the way we encounter the world, others, and ourselves, period. That should be pretty obvious, and yet, of course, through time immemorial, we'll be thinking and reflecting and kind of getting away from it. And phenomenology really tries to return to this fundamental aspect of being. So in a way, instead of thinking of, like Descartes said, I think, therefore I am, you could actually put it or rephrase it as I experience, therefore I am. So phenomenology argues that by going deep into the experience of being alive, we can grasp reality at any level. And you could go existentially on it, you could go ethically, you could go politically, ontologically, meaning the nature of being, but even transcendentally, and go to the deepest realms of the spiritual, if you wish. At the same time, of course, this is not as simple as it sounds. In order for you to approach the world phenomenologically in this more deeper way, there are two things required. One is you had to produce what is called the epoche in philosophy, or a state of openness, an openness of unconditioned or transparent non-belief, just openness, no bias. And the second one is a reduction, meaning you have to go to the point of the experience itself and just to look for what it is. Just remove everything else and just focus in that experience and be as open to what is appearing in your heart or mind. And if you do that, a few things may happen, and that's what phenomenology tells us. A revelation happens. Somehow you begin to experience, if that's possible, and it is, the experience becomes the experience. And as such, it begins to unfold in ways that reveal the essence or the most fundamental, primal dimension of being, which is the whole point, where you could actually retrieve the source of fears, the source of joy, the source of whatever condition you are trying to investigate. So this revelation is a revelation of being in the world. And that's why sometimes it's called ontological. Ontological is a weird meaning, a word that means basically the study of being. By looking deeper into the nature of experience, which is none other than consciousness itself, the revelation of being in the world happens. Now, I think this is a lot of wording. Hopefully you're still with me. Why this matter to architecture? Why at all we care about that? Well, you know, for sure, one reason, or maybe the most important reason, is despite all we are taught, and I'm a teacher, so I do this too, how we talk to each other in this kind of very high level of conversation, or very practical conversation, whatever it is, or will be published, the built world is encountered only through this experience. It's just experiences how we encounter the world. And there is no way to avoid this primordial or embodied condition. And therefore, in order for us to comprehend, produce, critique, engage architecture, the built environment, the city, we need to really consider the matter of experience, the matters of phenomenology. You know, who can say that understanding the Pantheon, perhaps the best building in the world, at least arguable, could come through the studies of plan elevation section or the talking that somebody can have with you by being in this place. Those of us have been lucky enough to be in that place are irrevocably transformed by the experience. Even though we study it in books and saw videos and you name it, photos, the act of being in the flesh in this place is transformative. And that's kind of the roots of the point of experience. Norbert Schultz, a very well-known theoretician of architecture, already dead, he spent so much time tirelessly speaking about, quote, existential space. That is a social cultural environment in which we experience life day after day in relation to other, not by our own selves. And of course, we can't forget Martin Heidegger, another philosopher, but very, very keenly aware of our architecture. And philosopher Heidegger discussed that the only way we could really think of being in the world, and therefore the architecture, is through what's called the fourfold. And the fourfold means four relationships that we need to engage phenomenologically. One is Earth. He talks about being on Earth, the sky, under the sky, among mortals, this horizontal, and in conversation with divinity. So our condition, our ontology, needs to be considered in this relationship with nature, something we're going to talk here today, cosmos, other people, and the transcendental or the sacred. So to conclude this very quick intro, to let the people that need to speak today to talk, we can say that it is even more than saying, and some people have discussed the possibility of experiences accessing something beyond the visible or the sensual or the emotional. And for instance, Husserl, which is the father of phenomenology, but also Jean-Luc Marion, a contemporary philosopher, talk about the excess of reality, the thing that reality continuously exceed our capacity to comprehend it. That is, every time you want to understand something, it's beyond your understanding. This overwhelming condition of reality foster not only our capacity of thinking what is beyond, but in reality foster our understanding or seeking to understand the mystical, the mythological, and also the metaphysical. Thus, phenomenology, to conclude, is a way to deal with the most fundamental question of being through our direct experiences. And an experience that actually happened always in relation to others. And therefore, as we'll see soon enough with Professor Casey Tolkien, always occurring at a point of edge, a point of interface, interstitial spaces. In other words, life is at the edge, at this condition of betweenness, liminality, if you wish, or interaction. And there's nothing better to do than looking at this condition through this experiential viewpoint. So, probably having killed the whole idea of phenomenology through my quick words, I hope that you have a better sense of what phenomenology is trying to do and why it's important to architecture. So what I would like to do now, since I'm out of time, and I'm gonna keep my time right, I would like to introduce our first speaker, Professor Ed Casey. Ed, you're here, you're there. So Ed Casey is a philosopher whose origin are in phenomenology, hermeneutics, and psychoanalysis. Presently distinguished professor at SUNY Stony Brook and former president of the American Philosophical Association Eastern Division, early in his career, he published closely descriptive studies of imagination and memory, after which he focused mainly on the role of place in people's concrete lives, as his books Getting Back into Place and the Fate of Place attest. More recently, he has published the companion volumes The World at a Glance and The World on Edge, each of which pursues periphenomenology of the lived world. Today he will draw on his last book, published in 2017, extending its analysis of edge to the harbor considered as an enclosing edge. Ed, please come to the podium. Let's welcome him.
Thank you, Julio. I appreciate that introduction. You've done everything now that I don't have to do, which is to talk about where I'm coming from. And I want to plunge right into a talk that I created for this very occasion. An edge, according to Socrates, is the limit of a solid. Now, we can regard this claim as an effort to tie edges to something determinate, to physical substance, as the paradigm of the assured and the reliable, the material and the tangible. But edges themselves are often experienced as fragile and tenuous, subject to sudden alteration. A hurricane can reconfigure an entire shoreline in one fell swoop. A mud flow descending from a mountain can sweep away a tall wall in a matter of minutes. Edges are often the most exposed parts of things. Contrary to Socrates' claim, they do not belong to physical things alone. There are edges of events, indicating where an event begins or ends in time, the edge of the storm, the deadline. The human psyche has its own edges, subject to testing and periodic breakdown. Anxiety, in particular, festers at the edges of experience. The very root of the word anxiety, which is angst, indicates a radical narrowing of a passage, hence the difficulty we have in breathing when we are in a severely anxious state. Now, anxiety may be a psychical state, but it can be occasioned by where we are situated or where we are going. The Pillars of Hercules in the ancient world, as they were called, these are narrows through which ancient mariners had to pass in order to encounter the unknown once in Oceanus, the world ocean, that, as many thought and feared, would end abruptly in a sheer precipice. That is the edge, the final edge, the last edge of the known world. So there were two geographical sources of anxiety in this situation, if you think about it, both bearing on edge, that of the unbounded and edgeless ocean, and that of the all too precipitous edge from where one can easily fall into the void. Fear of the open sea led many early sailors to practice costaggiare, moving from port to port slowly and carefully around the Mediterranean, hugging the edges of the coastline for safety. Motivating this cautious behavior was anxiety at the prospect of crossing directly over the Mediterranean, where weather can become suddenly tempestuous and one can lose one's way for lack of a perceived coastal set of edges. Analogs to this situation abound, of course, still today. Would you take a kayak into an open sea that was getting turbulent? Would you not keep your boat close to the shore if you ventured out at all in such a circumstance? So my working premise in my recent writings, and indeed throughout my entire life, although the recent writings have summed up what I've come to experience, this premise is that the life world, the world we all live in together, is an edge world. And that, this being so, anxiety will always lurk as a live, indeed a very likely, dimension of ongoing experience. But the shadow cast by edges is not absolute. Kierkegaard reminded us that anxiety is capable of revealing existential possibilities that might not ever have occurred to us otherwise. The practice of costaggiare is another case in point. Coping with the edges of the Mediterranean coastline led to an entire system of mariners' manuals called periploi that helped sailors to navigate this coastline for many centuries. It was an important chapter in the history of mapping in the West. You can say all that remarkable work came from anxiety about getting lost in the middle of the Mediterranean. Despite the fact that edge worlds come in many singular forms, let's say that there are two major kinds of edge worlds. In one, chaos rules supreme, and in the other, cosmos, that is, order and beauty, are to be found. Edges figure in the chasm of chaos by way of a sheer proliferation that does not result in any evident coherence, engendering an abyssal anxiety that stems from suspecting that no coherent pattern of figures or objects will ever emerge from such a maelstrom. In contrast, edges are integral to cosmoi, that is, ordered worlds that display harmonious and non-invasive edges that coordinate all closely with each other, the effect being beauty of a special sort, a beauty deriving from the co-inherence of edges with each other. Such edges do not close down or close off, as is the case with limitative or restrictive edges. They serve to draw together and to open up. Rather than repelling, they attract. So let's now switch scenes from the ancient Mediterranean seaworld to contemporary Baltimore and its harbor. We move thereby from a large body of water with numerous harbors at its perimeter, between which Phoenician and Greek and Egyptian and later Italian navigators made their way, to a single, partially enclosed modern harbor. Despite all the differences in historical era and local topography, the two scenes share a major edge circumstance. Each exhibits and is structured by edges that connect land and sea. Beyond being the basis of literal physical contiguity, such edges manifest another dimension. And this is what I'm going to be talking about as the core of my talk. Starkly said, each such edge is an edge between land and sea, and in my printed text, I capitalize each of these three words, edge, land, sea. Such capitalization signifies that I intend these terms in ways that are at once material and ontological. Material as sensed and felt before my face or under my feet, ontological as instantiating ways of being. That is, ways of being elemental. This literal double entendre indicates that we are dealing here not just with local geography or topography, but with what can be called geo-ontology, ways of being, land, sea, and edge. This is to suggest that we have to do with entire regions of earth being, and thus that we enter into what I shall be calling geochorology, where chora, C-H-O-R-A, transliterated, the root of chorology, signifies place and especially region. For regions are whole sectors of the earth, whether landed or aqueous or aerial. They make up not just its literal geography, but its characteristic ways of being in space. Being disposed and situated there, being modalized in multiple ways, ways of being there. There as that very place, that harbor, that is, let's say, Baltimore's. Here I actually am alluding to what Julio expressed as the primacy of experience, of direct experience, first-person experience, that you must come to trust at some level if you're going to navigate this anxious life world at all. Now, when we say spontaneously and without forethought, let's go down to the harbor tonight, we're proposing that we visit a space that is geo-ontologically and geo-chorologically present. We're not just going to a local harbor with all of its peculiarities and discrete features. In the case of Baltimore, for instance, the many landings and docks that have come to populate, indeed to overpopulate in some parts, the original harbor, we are going down to the sea, down to a primary way that Earth regionalizes itself. Moreover, the down is not meant merely literally, but reflects the fact that we are moving from land to sea, considered as two major ways in which what Husserl calls the earth basis distributes itself. Earth basis, Erdboden in German, not just the geographical planet, but a way by which we are subtended, supported, brought up, set forth, exist, all those terms meaning standing out from being on Earth itself as a primal carrier for human lives and, of course, all lives with life on Earth. So there's a primal directionality in this movement. We are moving from a land mass, if we're going down to the harbor again, to a water mass that lies just beyond and below it, below at varying depths, but decidedly below. If this basic directionality is lost, we are faced with flooding, a real prospect in Baltimore with the rising of the Atlantic Ocean coming from climate change. But the belowness has as much to do with the relationality of two geo-regions as with the actual sea level. Here, land, again, capital L, and my way of speaking, is experienced as above the sea, even if barely so. This is why we say that we stand upon the land, not only on bare earth, but on structures built upon it, such as docks and walkways, as is so conspicuously the case with the Baltimore Harbor. Now, in addition to this inherent geodirectionality that proceeds from above to below, and of course from the reverse, if we turn around and go back to where we came from, in going to the Baltimore Harbor, we are not just moving from a specific location in the Baltimore area to the harbor as a discrete and delimited place. I'm trying to get us to imagine together that we are moving from, let's call it being on land, all that hyphenated, to being at the edge of the sea, all that hyphenated. We're going from one geo-ontological state to the other. Each such state is a state of being in the earth world. And we are in such states thanks to our bodily agency, regarded as itself a moving edge in places that are comparatively unmoving. As bodily beings, we stand on and move over what underlies and supports and stays largely the same. This is land, regarded as a primal region of being on Earth. Land is composed of multiple localities, but it, land, capital L, is the stationary underlying fundament of them all. As such, it is a constituent element of Earth, integral to the Earth basis itself. This means that it is ontological and not only experiential. Or more exactly, let's say, in being experienced, it is sensed in its very being. And Julio again helps us by having said quite clearly that ontology is the study of the nature of being. Now, sea, in contrast with land, is a different story. Here, all is movement, which is not to be reduced to the bodies or boats that float in it, and fish that swim in it. Movement is the very nature of being sea being. Its being consists in moving, however differentially. So much so in the case of oceans and large seas that harbors have to be built as enclaves, places constructed to secure safety from exposure to what in English we call tellingly the high seas. Themselves, of course, a major source of maritime anxiety, ancient and contemporary. An ocean or sea is a primal region of the Earth. It is both geo-ontological, a way Earth is, and geo-chorological, that is a constituent region of the Earth. Now, between land and sea, there is edge. As with all edges, This one both separates and unites, disconnects and connects. We call it conventionally the shoreline, but it is not a line. Few lines as such exist in nature, even if shorelines exhibit fractal features that invite linear representation, linear and mathematical representation. And it, of course, doesn't always count as shore. The many shops and restaurants, again, ringing the Baltimore Harbor, are hardly shore-like. But I have in mind something more primal than this. This is the edge between two parsings of the Earth's regionality and is something quite unique in each and every case. You will never meet or observe this edge as such. That is the edge between land and sea. And yet, it is unquestionably, undeniably there, there between land and sea. We sense it when standing on any beach or cliff, or for that matter, on a dock or landing of the Baltimore Harbor itself. And this extends the reach of land, to the very edge of sea. We hear its echo when we pronounce the seemingly innocent phrase in English, at water's edge, whose apparent simplicity conceals a basic way of being drawn to the very perimeter of being on land, and yet also equally at the periphery of the sea. As T.S. Eliot put it in The Dry Salvages, the river is within us, the sea is all about us. The sea is the land's edge also, the granite into which it reaches, the beaches where it tosses, its hints of earlier and other creation. Eliot here reverses our usual inclination to regard the critical edge to belong to land, to a cliff or to the beach, by saying that the sea can itself just as well be considered the land's edge. This is to point to what I'd like to call the biunivocal character of the edge as I am discussing it here tonight. It is always one edge, that one between a given stretch of land and sea, and serves to distinguish them, but it is also at once and at the same time the edge of land and water alike. So I'm maintaining that a very special edge is located, is found between land and sea, where they conjoin, and again, all of those words still in caps, however calmly or fitfully this may happen in a particular case. Such an edge is not their common element. There is no common element. That is why ancient peoples insisted on the separate subsistence of the basic elements of air, fire, earth, and water. Nor is this edge some kind of thing. An edge of any kind is always on its way to disappearance. An edge is, as it were, always perishing as your view or touch goes around it to where it no longer exists. And yet an edge is never nothing either. It is a positive presence as the geologic, in this case we're discussing tonight, as the geoontological meeting of land and sea. This meeting is not reducible to conventional geological parameters, even if these latter do serve to specify it for certain practical purposes. As such, this edge, the edge that I'm trying to get us to imagine together tonight, is an edge of edges, an edge that connects the myriad discrete edges that connect land and sea in their finite forms, their discrete instantiations. And yet, it is something that has a being of its own, which is what allows me to designate it with this highfalutin language. I know no other, because we have to resort to extreme syntax and vocabulary to stretch our collective imaginations around it. It's what allows me to designate it as, let's say, geoontological, that is, a way of being of and on Earth, and as geocorological, that is, as an edge between the primal regions of land and sea. Now, by employing awkward terms like geoontological and geocorological. I mean to take maximal distance from the kind of edge that we can designate as edge at. That is to say, a verge. Verge means being on edge, being edgy, as when we become anxious. And it also means leaning over the edge so as to catch a glimpse of oneself in the water. Narcissus was on the verge when he bent over the edge just far enough to be able to see his reflected face in the water and to fall in love with it. I contrast this with a situation in which being situated between land and water is an occasion rather for an expansive consciousness that concerns far more than a reflected image of oneself in the water. In short, one's individuated ego. To gain this extended awareness, one needs to stand back from the edge as sheer verge so as to enter a different dimension than the ego by itself can ever deliver. It is a matter of taking stock of thinking from the edge, thereby entering a zone of transformation where insights of another order can emerge. Commenting on the representation of water in medieval manuscripts of the 12th to 14th centuries, Michael Camilla remarks that, quote, "The edge of the water was where wisdom revealed itself. The edge of the water was where wisdom revealed itself." Now, this offers a clue as to why human beings are so deeply drawn to the edge of the sea, whether naturally given, as with beaches or sea cliffs, or humanly constructed in the form of piers and boardwalks. This edge, taken with the right gravity, affords a unique point of access to geoontological realization, that is, at the level of being, as bearing on what is lasting, and not only that of becoming, concerning how things change as in the details of ever-changing tidal patterns. So we're talking now about seeing into how things are, or what how things are what they are, that is, an expansive ecological awareness of Earth as such, water as such, and land as such. Going down to the sea, being at water's edge, and other such sayings indicate that being at the edge between land and sea is a privileged place for the gaining of insight, not easily attainable, if at all accessible, in other locations. Such an edge is the very place of transition between elemental regions, of which earth and sea are archetypal exemplars, and thus constitutes a unique perch from which what we name wisdom is accessible. Wisdom, after all, that has been the guiding goal of philosophy since Socrates in the West and the spiritual practices in the East, but that must now include today an ecological sensibility, given that we're here talking about naturally given geoontological regions on an imperiled planet. It takes edge as a third term between sea and land to bring us to the brink of an understanding not otherwise attainable, otherwise or otherwhere. You can test this out yourself later this evening by taking a quiet walk around the Baltimore Harbor. Most of the shops and restaurants will have closed down by then, as if in deference to the simple but transformative experience of being by the edge. Being where, being on the edge by which, land and sea converge to make possible thinking of another order. Thinking at once geocorological, that is, of land and sea as great regions of the earth, geocorological and, I say, geoontological, which is to say, thinking of the being of earth as the basis of all that we do and think and say and do. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Ed. Let me introduce the next speaker, Travis Price. Travis is an architect, environmental pioneer, author, educator, and philosopher. He has developed over the past four decades a modern architecture that works hand-in-hand with ecology and mythology, restoring the spirit of place to modern design. His vision is grounded in real-life success with large-scale AIA award-winning private and public works, including the world's largest solar building for the Tennessee Valley Authority. He has planned new towns and designed an array of unique individual residences, commercial properties, and institutional monuments. He coined the term, quote, passive solar, end of quote, which is his early green architecture works in New Mexico. He installed the first wind turbine in Manhattan, which initiated the Public Utilities Regulation Policy Act, allowing cogeneration of wind and solar energy with public utilities. In concert with the Catholic University of America as adjunct professor, Travis Price founded and directs the nonprofit Spirit of Place, Spirit of Design. Let's welcome Travis Price to the podium.
Hey, y'all. Kathleen warned me not to use the word edgy after I'd already printed it, but I really thought it was the... Can you guys hear me okay? Yeah, I tend to want to walk around. I go Italian when I'm walking. Good? Good. Back. Yeah, I'll do it here. It's great. Thanks, yeah. How's that? Good. I want to take you to my edge, if you would. So much was just said that really my mind was exploding with imagination. But I want you just for a minute to relax. Helps me relax. But look at edges from a much larger perspective. Like when I experience nature, when I go global, which I do a lot, I mean, I love the places where like ice melts into water. Or what's that sand? You know, now I'm moving all that wonderful, wonderful ontological and phenomenological rap into something I call a rhapsody. When you start getting deeper into that edge, what does it speak to? And of course, nature. Nature is always echoing in all of us. And you see the word you, you'll see that once in a while. And I tell people, was that a microscope? But no. That's the ice melting up in New England just in the early spring, and those are trees down below. And I just want to massage you into this thing of when I cut an edge, I start to create something. And I'm going to move into a much larger edge, which I think is where nature meets the human mind, not necessarily just what the human mind does with nature. And I often ask people if they would like to eat sushi with taffy. But then if you look at those edges, you realize it's a sewer plant from 500 feet up. So I want to get your eyes to feel a bigger thing. But more importantly, this slide to me, some images down in in the Peruvian Amazon. Who's it for? And it's for people. And it's for this interaction with people. And eventually, of course, it makes you really understand the value of what Cristo did. He took this metaphysical principle and sort of applied it to make nature and the edge even stronger. And for me, that's what I often tell my students and I tell my clients even, that remember, the moon is not round. The moon is the moon. Thank you, Aristotle. The round is here, and I put round on the moon, and we all have round. And so as I move along, I begin to see along that edge poetry. And thank God you brought T.S. Eliot up. He's a god. But these echoes of eternity, these senses of what's left when you look at that big picture of what the tides do. And so when I see all that, I ask myself, okay, but now who are we? What are we actually experiencing? What is our legacy in this century? There's so many classical pieces of architecture. And I've come to the dreadful conclusion that sprawl, mall, tall, and now virtual is probably the, and I love the word I in there because we know what that alludes to, this obsession with becoming apes again with our fingers all day. But it sort of sets into motion the notion that, you know, it's all about me and it's all about consumption and it's mostly about homogenization. And so here's the contest that's going to happen, I think, around the Baltimore Edge is they're coming, they're going to keep coming, and they are us. And in the end, what are cities along that edge going to do? Well, we don't want this reward in the desert. It's uncanny that people actually save their money to go to these places instead of the real places. Or 15, 20 years ago, working in Kathmandu, that all of that was temples and beautiful, beautiful edges of the divine. Now it's one big mercantile mandala, mantra almost, consumption, consumption. And eventually the deconners will take us into this kind of non-axis mundi, and we will never know who we are whence we come. And this always brings me back to what I really want to show you about some expeditions very quickly, where we sought, as does Ilya, to sort of see, if you can read it to whatever degree he may have desacralized the world, the man who has made his choice in favor of a profane life never succeeds completely in doing away with religious behavior. It's embedded in everything that's human. The psychology, if you want to call it, the sacred, as Julie and I often share discussions. And so what happens, this is Elvis now. Where is the sacred when the profane is all that is built or remembered? And if we approach the harbor with this understanding, I think it's going to change the whole game of what's going on with this consumption. But in a modern secular world, the faster the consumption of thought, like on Google, the less memory. We don't remember the crisis 2 days ago. Metaphysics ceases to be even discussed, much less experienced. Where is our sacred place in a Carl Jungian sense? Where does time stand still, especially in a democratic existentialist world? So my whole voyage for me has been to find that edge where the spirit of geography meets the geography of the spirit, that they are two separate worlds. I love it, and I love the contradiction and the paradox of it. So many years ago, I formed a small group at Catholic U to go build two outhouses in the Stikine wilderness. And it began a whole process of 9 days, a process where we essentially took 10 to 20 students at Catholic University. Thank God the dean there was Stanley Hallett, Jewish dean, PhD in Islamic architecture at Catholic University. Go figure. So I said, I want to take a bunch of students, Dan, and I want to take them up to the Yukon to my friend Wade Davis's hunting lodge, and we want to build two outhouses. I mean, that sounds great. But we're going to base them on the Kwakiutl tribal mythologies, and these are going to shape things within nature, but shape them to the shape of the metaphysical realm, and that's the realm I want to talk about. So all these I'm going to blast you through them, but they're all one semester of studying an ancient mythology of a great place, and it could be Baltimore Harbor, it could be what you'll see later, and then coming up with the poetic, a metaphor, a lyric, a sculpture, something that actually evokes it and put that back into a modern idiom. And so what Kathleen asked me to do on this is to sort of just come up and show you some of those on the water. Now, astonishingly, every one of these projects is designed in a semester, detail, materials are raised and arrived, and everything you're about to see is built in 9 days. This was one of two projects. This is where the 10 places come, and I'll show you more about it. But since 24 years, we've gone around the globe. Literally, this is my Indiana Jones moment. Don't call me Spartacus. But this was around the globe, and we are just constantly overwhelmed with the number of people who want to find the ancient story along an edge somewhere and build it. So for instance, from Run Rainforest in the Northwest, we went to the Amazon. Now this picture is about 120 clicks north of a really fantastic little town. It's 500,000 people called Iquitos. There's only one way to get to Iquitos. It's by jet, it takes an hour, or the second way you can come in on the Amazon, which is 3.5 months. 500,000 people live there. There's so much ancient, deep, rich. There's even a shaman union, if you would believe. And but in this place, in Iquitos, the entire town literally is 8 to 12 feet underwater, the first floors, every year. And then the rainy season goes, comes up, that's Venice, and then when it goes down, it's a villa. It's like a little village in Mexico. And so in this remote area, we built in 9 days a house floating in the 10,000 senses. In the Amazon, there's 10,000 shades of green, 10,000 cacophonous sounds at dawn. It is astonishing to watch nature kill itself and regenerate at such a pace. Only have I seen that in Africa. But here was a house built by students to celebrate that moment of floating 10 feet away from the water, and to have researchers from National Geographic and occasional DEA boys would stop in for a hello going up to Columbia. But this was built with the Arapi Indians and based on all their storytelling, all their thacho. Oh, Ireland, you know, west of Dublin, after you've had your pint, go west. Go to the heartbeat. Go to where everything is lyrical and nothing's logical, and that's where all of it starts. But on this west coast, I ran into a group who in 1996 were actually building sculptures based on these stories. And that's where I really learned where the real metaphysics is. It's the storytelling of the human story. And the tir soya, it's in Gaelic, means tir means earth, and soya is one word that means the salt-laden air, which kills everything and turns it into moss, which then turns it into sod, and eventually turns it into stuff you don't want to walk in because it'll swallow you. But along that coastline, and I've seen waves go over that lighthouse at 200 feet in the air, is this extraordinary pace. And there are these giant blowholes. And these are human stories, once again, coming to life as architecture. And in this one, this is a tin place. A tin place in Gaelic life and in normal life in Western Ireland is where the past and the future and the present morph. And you have these extraordinary timeless kairos experiences versus the chronos of the Greeks. And on that point, standing there, one can come in and inhale and watch that wave hit. It was 130 feet as it shoots up through. At the same moment, 6 miles away in full light, we decided to have the land eat the sea. And what was amazing was you could see these two projects, because this, all that rock that looks so beautifully zen and laid out is all coughed up by the sea. It's the right at the very edge of a primordial ring fort, but more importantly, right at the edge where a rock could kill you, and if you step back 5 feet for centuries, it couldn't. And we built a piece that was disintegrating, looking out, and one goes there. And I can't tell you how many people go there and find suddenly, after 6 months of mourning, rest, or would go there to announce they're married. Remember, in all landscapes, as Seamus Caulfield once says, it's all a state of mind. Two people were standing there talking about the child that had drowned in their family. Two people else came up and said, remember when we kissed here the first time and we got married? So that human story, but making a piece of architecture on that edge between nature and that was great. This was a spot in Belmullet, rated as the wildest city of all Ireland 5 years in a row, was a place where everyone left to get on a coffin boat to go to America, to get away from the famine and that 600 years of slavery with the British. And the Temple of the Tides of Time was built, and these were thistles that sang, and one thing went yin and yang, back and forth, in and out. And as Seamus once said, when someone said, what are you Americans doing here without telling us Irish what we think? Well, I'm half Irish, so I got, that's okay. But the point is, he said, look, the tide that comes in is not the same as the tide that goes out. But without each other, they cannot exist. And these are, to me, these moments, these echoes, these metaphors, these pieces that the students study. And then, without ever knowing what a chisel or a hammer is, in 9 days, they put these together. Another extraordinary cultural experience was the Kalevala Keitto. And this is in Helsinki. The Kalevala is a 5,000-year-old epic poem. It is the Homer of the Nordic peoples. And that's Väinämöinen on the right fighting with his sword or with his song. This is a modern painting making Hunk of Burning Love, Elvis. Quit. Okay. 5 minutes. Once again, every student that we worked with, we had to build models, poems, sculptures, and we did all of this in 9 days as well, the design in 4 days sessions at the Finnish embassy in D.C. And then literally got on the machines, brought Karelian wood in from the most sacred mountains of the Kalevala, and in 9 days of construction with Utukumpus, fantastic stainless steel. You created a place that was an egg of creation, but there are only two ways to travel in Finland before cars, either on sleds or on boats. That was it. So this is a place where one goes in, thinks for 2 hours, or meets a group of people, and then you come out and make a decision after. This just shows you, I mean, the epic song is still sung, and the opening was extraordinary. Or Inishturk Island, Mayo. I mean, it's down to, what, 45 people. It used to be several hundred. A lost island off the coast. Good guys, bad guys. But Inishturk Island is 9 miles off. You can only get there on the Pirate Queen. And we do entrust the O'Toole's. Danny O'Toole is an extraordinary piece. On this island, with that distant mountain in the crevasse, which is Crowpatrick, the most sacred place in Ireland, we were asked by the community to once again bring the clans together and tell the tale of Tongs. Day in and day out, there's a documentary film on this. I mean, it would be freezing. There are four seasons a day, and then it'd be sweltering hot. But slowly, the notion here was to copy the sea islands into the stone, to create a place where all the Irish, that year, it was the huge, huge event, to come home to water your roots. And so the gathering happened on Inishturk Island. Fantastic piece, sunset and peat burning. And the story is essentially, you took your tongs, you took the coal out of your fire, you put it in your parents', your brother's house, on the promise one day when you came back, if you ever could, from the famine years, that you would grab your tong again, take the coal, and relight your fire in your home. This was a huge thing, and we began to win. The last eight projects have won national AIA IFRA awards. The Sea Stack and the Crossing, where St. Patrick literally fought Broomcliff, the fantastic Celtic god, and beat him and created this gigantic blowhole. That hole is, and the mountain around it, were all one of our projects with 240 stainless steel thistles. And talk about kayaking. That tunnel, that light you see there, is almost 3 football fields away. It's a sacred tunnel. So we're always finding these places where the landscape is sacred, where there's a story to be told, and where there's a group of people who are dedicated to doing it. Our last project in Cong, which is a little town that borders a river, a very small water element. There are Roman ruins in Ashford Castle. This is Dublin, of course. But right on this little river, which separates County Galway from County Mayo, is a place where there was a 7th century monk's fishing cottage sitting there. And here was where the students came, was nothing. And the theme this year, including my, we call them the Mosaic team, because the Irish couldn't say mosaic very easily. We built a place that was based on the great human story of not only the Christ and casting the net, fishers of men you shall be, but also Mana Mac Léir, the great sea god who would take people to the other world and the nether world and bring them back again. So when one enters this project, wow, you are finally in a place where you're under the sea, you're being lifted by that power. At the same time, you are being also teased into being captured. This is the stainless steel glass roof. But the most important thing was the village priest loved that combination of the pagan and the Catholic, because that is what it is to be Irish Catholics. So Spirit of Place is there. The only people suffering are in recently are the sheep who, you know, lose their wool frequently and the Ramsbottom piece. And these projects have generated huge things that we're working on now, a memorial to all who died at sea during World War II, both the Axis and the Allies. This will be a walkout to just celebrate names all the way up the mountain that it takes to climb here. The highest vertical accessible peaks in all of Europe. Or Keene Bay, where now every year the Irish are going to announce the greatest new poet, the greatest new songwriter. So these are projects that I've written about in The Mythic Modern, which is one of my two books. The other is The Archaeology of Tomorrow, my own work. But be careful now. You've just taken a mystical ride where the sea eats the land and the land eats the sea, and the human story actually meets the natural story. That's the edge I wanted to get you at. But the sea people are eating the land. And this is my just bit of humor about our recent sea container projects, where we're actually invading from the sea some few thousand of the 33 million sea containers are moving it every 1 second every day. But I just wanted to show you that there's a transaction. There's an attitude that I just wanted to describe, where everything that was said earlier actually can start to form the most dynamic edge, I hope, for the harbor, which is tell stories, human stories, and let nature dance with that. Thank you.
Thank you, Travis. Let me introduce our last speaker tonight, Carmela Thomas. She is the Baltimore Program Manager for the Chesapeake Bay Foundation. She manages oyster gardening in Baltimore's Inner Harbor, growing over 20,000 baby oysters in the Baltimore Harbor, and advocacy actions through connecting to issues through hands-on learning experiences. Through her role as Program Manager of the Healthy Harbor Initiative, Thomas has connected Baltimore's residents and Baltimore City school students to the waterfront, leading educational workshops about pollution issues in the harbors and the Chesapeake Bay, while offering solutions and awareness to make the harbors swimmable and fishable. Thomas has a passion for raising awareness and inspiring others to be stewards of the land and water around the bay. Let's welcome Carmela.
Good evening. For the past 30 years, the Chesapeake Bay Foundation has worked with teachers and students at the water and on our education vessels to educate about the harbor and the bay. And for the past 8 years, CBF has engaged residents in hands-on restoration projects at the harbor, and we work with agencies and other groups to encourage policies aimed at improving water quality in the Chesapeake Bay watershed. This is a photo from Ghosts of Baltimore. This is Baltimore in 1948, once a major port for shipping. But by the 1950s, economic changes ended freight use, and the waterfront gradually transformed to the attractions that we see today. We see tall buildings surrounding the waterfront with hard edges and little to no direct contact to the water unless you're in a boat or walking around the promenade. There was an increase in human-driven attractions, but we still see a lot of commercial usage and tourist attractions around the water. I share this image because when we think about usage of the waterfront, it should be accessible to all residents. This image is from data compiled by the Urban Institute, and this image coined the phrase, the white L and the black butterfly. We must acknowledge that the history of racial segregation in this city impacts what we still feel today, reflected in investments in amenities and services or lack thereof. The Growing Green Initiative, first introduced in 2015 under Stephanie Rawlings Blake, was a competition citywide to encourage investment in the green and park spaces that connect city residents to open space, but also that lead directly to the water. That plan has changed slightly, and the idea of connecting to the city through green space, bike lanes, parks, and more to encourage citywide connection to those spaces and the water's edge are generated through activity where most people are located. Creating activities to encourage human activity at the harbor is really important to allow those connections to the edge to happen. And the way that we use space is a key point when thinking about how we access those spaces and the type of activation that occurs. Canton is an example of that. This waterfront park is free, and it's an open space that residents utilize, and tourists as well, to get to and from work, relax, and enjoy concerts and other activities. It's also a launch point for water access. I share this example of Masonville Cove. Once a neighborhood, Masonville was cut off from city access by highways for trucks and other traffic. It ended up being a dumping ground, but in 2004, the Army Corps of Engineers and the Maryland Port Administration offer to restore and preserve the natural habitat and landscape of Masonville. And they constructed an environmental education center as part of a harbor dredging project. Since 2007, Masonville Cove is home to pieces of birds, fish, and native plants. Over 14,000 tons of wood and debris were removed to make way for the site that you see here. Spaces like these are necessary for human experiences at the water's edge. Typical recreation in the Inner Harbor can also serve as an opportunity to clean it up. This is a canoe and scoop program that the Recreation of Parks leads. Or connections through the Baltimore Flotilla that was introduced by the Waterfront Partnership of Baltimore. And over 200 paddlers rally for clean water to make the harbor swimmable and fishable. Or the Kids and Kayaks program through Baltimore City Rec and Parks that offers an opportunity for residents to connect to the nature around them. Over 500 fifth graders participate in this program. Our connection to water is also driven by science and restoration. Like I mentioned, CBF is working to improve water quality around the Chesapeake Bay, and the Patapsco River is a great study site. Waterfront Partnership and CBF collaborated to create the Great Baltimore Oyster Partnership. It engages students, the public, and corporate companies around the Inner Harbor in oyster restoration. Not only are these participants taking care of oysters, which are juvenile oysters attached to recycled shells and grown in cages for about 9 months, but they also help change the attitude towards a perceived lifeless waterway. This location is behind Nick's Fish House at Baltimore Yacht Basin, and this one at Downtown Sailing Center. These oysters really do well, despite the poor water quality and the skepticism that oysters could not grow in the harbor. Over 500,000 have been planted on our oyster gardening reef, and we have a goal of 5 million in the river by 2020. Some residents may not have direct access to water or the Inner Harbor, but there are many barriers to overcome, including limited transportation, cost, attraction, and overall acceptance. But connecting residents to their water in various ways can help inspire stewardship and action. Storm drains in the city connect to waterways. Tracing the path of trash or other debris might be the first connection to water that some residents have, like these lovely kindergartners here. This block in Patterson Park worked with Waterfront Partnership's Alley Makeover Program to transform its alley to a river. This neighborhood and 17 others in the Harris Creek watershed all connect through a piped creek underneath Southeast Baltimore. A resilient city not only implements reductions to energy and transportation and leaves room for adaptation, but it directly prepares for impacts of climate change. The growing impacts of climate change is becoming a more prevalent issue for many urban communities, especially Baltimore. Threats from sea level rise and flooding paired with aging water systems is a cause for disaster, but preparedness and planning is key. It also impacts transportation, and we really need to create plans to mitigate these challenges now. This lot in West Baltimore directly addresses stormwater runoff and climate change through green infrastructure. About 20% of the stormwater from surrounding impervious surfaces is reduced through this vacant lot renovation. Renovating this lot is a demonstration project, but it shows how climate change impacts can be mitigated economically through the use of vacant lots, local labor, and also community support. Baltimore is working on projects right now to implement green infrastructure through environmental impact bonds or pay-for-performance models. So projects like this might be popping up in neighborhoods near you. A connected Baltimore really works together on solutions to address these pressing issues, especially to a resource, to water, that connects us all. So how will we create a city that's equitable, accessible, and resilient? I can really only hope that it will be a space that is activated through the lens of inclusivity and connecting to nature. Thank you.
So in terms of me asking any smart question here, I think it'll be better for the audience to participate, since you've been listening a little bit too long. So any questions you want to ask our speakers tonight? Or any issues or anything you want to raise? Here's this. Please use the microphone if you can.
Good evening. Byrne Kelly, landscape architect. I know Travis Price quite well. And I want to thank the speakers, because the three speakers and what they spoke about suggests to me that the design competition could be very interesting, and that the dynamics and the overlay or the intersection or intercourse of each of their talks was at first somewhat abstract, but now it all comes together, so I congratulate you.
Thank you. Do you agree?
Yeah, definitely.
That was a really hard, that was a very hard question.
There's a question, gentlemen.
Can you hear me if I speak like this?
Yes.
All right. I'm Leon Bridges, and I'd like to ask a question, not of Ms. Thomas, because you are more aware of Baltimore Harbor, but the other two, as you have seen Baltimore Harbor, what are your ideas, just off the top of your head, as to anything?
That's the very top of my head. I don't know. It was really interesting listening to everybody tonight, and it just seems to me I really would just love to see a big dance going on between things that extend out into the harbor and bringing the harbor much to the environmental level inward, but really watching it done in a 21st century way, where you really start to get delight, but you also get fed an experience. That the sea and the human activity. I wasn't kidding. Seeing sea containers pop out and seeing them go in at the same time, maybe they're roofed in all kinds of floating ecological pads. And but to make sure that it has delight, because I think in the end, through all these discussions, delight is what brings people to the edge with a little less anxiety.
I was struck visiting the harbor this afternoon with Randy and Craig Purcell at the need to transform what was actually a very constructive interim solution, that is the brick walkway, which surely improved upon the inaccessibility of the harbor earlier, but at the need for, as we spoke together, softening the edge, which really means bringing land in one form or another right to the edge. So that there's no need to put in this artificial third term called, you know, brick or construction as much as possible. It can't be done everywhere and in any way, but the more that could be seen, that it's really possible to bring the land to the sea, the better. And it seemed to me that this is the way that the Baltimore Harbor could become paradigmatic for other harbors, given that there's a lot of will to vision and change, and we heard that in your talk especially. I think the time is really ripe for a truly creative, socially and politically creative action that would bring land to sea. And that's going to be at the edge, as the edge, let's say.
I imagine a harbor that is much softer than it is right now, with direct connection to the water. I am an educator at heart, so I really wish that there was some center where people could come and actually use the resource and touch and feel and really enjoy that. So.
Yeah, I want to just add living memorials of sea and land and people. Dancing, like just as you said, bringing land there, I would, on the one hand, just take a little more fire and mix it with the sand and make glass walkways that go 30 feet out where you are literally hanging over space, as much as I would bring the sea in. And this seesaw, if you would, effect would give us both. You'd start become more vague, but more enlightening.
A question it's just with building on this remark, is how to distinguish between, but also how to connect the environmental, the sacred, and what I was calling the ontological, seems to me to be very important. So it's to really have the largest vision of what this very special edge can be in all of its basic dimensions. So how to realize that all at once in a vision that allows us to dance on the edge of those differences seems to me to be like really what's really critical here. This would take a visionary set of architectural geniuses to figure out, and the public would benefit enormously from this. Access to the spiritual, access to what I am calling the ontological, and access to the environmental. Not to mention that with which you began, accessibility to neighborhoods of residents, of all residents of Baltimore. How to do that all at once becomes the challenge.
So one question back there.
Yes, Mark Howard. I'm a planner and I work for the State Highway Administration. Mm. We're seeing a lot of legislation being introduced down in Annapolis, which is telling us to build our facilities to be higher, stronger, more armored, more flood-proof, and this is equated in some people's minds with resilience. And in my mind, I think we need to be, in some senses, softer, more capable of sort of rebounding from flooding and from extreme weather events. That when you come back from a flood or an inundation or something like that, that you can recover without having built higher, stronger, more armored, but to be more flexible and to be able to recover your facilities without having spent the money to, make it a more armored and more imposing and more, less forgiving kind of facility. And I'd like to get your reaction to that.
If I can start, the way that the bay looked before people, it was mostly marshes, and in a natural environment, marshes are like the kidneys of the land. So with the increase of sea level rise and water just really taking over, I think about the water edges and being more like marshes, where that they can handle the impact of the water. Because before us and before buildings and roads and things like that, that's how nature dealt with water and wave action and storm surge. So replacing that natural habitat is key. And I know that we see that now, the way that we're moving towards green infrastructure and things like that. But There needs to be more of it, but it's really hard to accommodate the amount of people that live here in this city and across the watershed. But.
And I think this last question is really a key. I think Americans are all too drawn to fortress-like mentalities. I've just spent some time at the southern border, and I've written a book on the wall at the border, and I argue there that wall thinking, muralistic, so to speak, is the beginning of the end. It's wholly defensive. It's usually the sign of a dying imperialism rather than anything more constructive. And so how to question the recourse, the unthinking, spontaneous recourse to fortification, of which walls are clearly a leading example, is something we need to rethink as a whole people. It's all too easy, all too tempting. The Army Corps of Engineers often went there earlier. Now I think they're reconsidering. But how to get away from this obsession with the impenetrable fortified wall or any other such structure becomes a challenge of our time.
I think there's a blur of this, because I love the word softening. But you know, when you get to a city like Baltimore, I mean, it's not like you're going to have marshlands again and mosquitoes and blah 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 blah. So but the idea of going up on columns, we just worked on a big project in Galveston, which gets hit all the time, regardless of climate change. But going up on the colonies and looking at some of the old cultures in the Polynesian world, Peloponnesian as well, but. It's going up on columns and building cities where that ebb and flow actually becomes part of your foundation, and there you do have the strength of steel. We're doing 12-foot high colonnades now to put sea container housing on, and it suddenly it's Venice, and that's not such a bad place to be. Yeah.
Just one more question. Right there.
If I could make a first comment on that, Thales was the first recognizable philosopher in the West, and Thales had, we only know one sentence from Thales, one fragment, and that fragment is, all is water. Now that's pretty challenging, because in the world of perception and practical use, you'd say, no, only part of the world is water, but he's trying to expand our vision to something else. A larger vision, and what I was doing in my own fumbling way was to do something comparable. Today we need to rethink the whole idea of basic elements: land, water, air, earth. Heidegger was already going there. There's no question this was an inspiration for his work, but we need to take it further, because he didn't really have a sense of environmental disaster impending, as we now do. So it isn't a matter of going to the past for its own sake. It's a matter of reopening vision of what we call basic elements, and rethinking how they penetrate our lives much more pervasively and deeply than we give credit to when we think of water as a commodity or something to be controlled. How to open our eyes to that larger dimension of something like water or land or air, of course, not to restrict it to land and sea. That's just where the issue of edge meets in Baltimore.
I still take on the fifth element, spirit, because I really think we're talking about Baltimore Harbor now, and along the great swath of landscapes to preserve them forever is paramount. There's no one doubts it. But when it comes to actual human habitation, we can't retreat. We can extend, we can go up, but we have to give some sort of Aikido, if you would, to this design where there's an ebb and flow. Something is dynamic, and yes, we are 70% water ourselves. Yeah. And I think it's in the cradle, in the womb, we're used to that. And I think if we can get that attitude going, yeah, as you say, dance with it, we would see a natural feeling. Even if we didn't see a plant or a fish, we'd feel that flow of nature in us. And I think those were those big pictures I was showing, like, you gotta be in touch with the big picture of what nature is. And it's not BTUs on the head of a pin. It's really larger emotional reactions. So if the building's in the action, reacts to it, I think people will respect it. Mm-hmm. That's the spirit world for me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I would just add, embrace it and adapt to it the way that we have done over time. So that's
it. I think we should close this. I want to say just one thing. The city of the spirit of the edge, the spirit of Baltimore, and the spirit of nature, how you bring all together. I think this conversation that started like the first person asked the question beats well for the competition. You know, you bring the kind of very high philosophical, and because phenomenology is being driven through your words, is very concrete. And then you have the Carmeras, you know, effort at bringing awareness and change and a very concrete, real day-to-day operation right now. And then Travis' storytelling and metaphor and the spirit as a connection between the other two. I think it's a very nice way to inspire, hopefully, lots of entry to the competition. So thank you, everybody. Let me return this to Kathleen.
Thank you. Thank you, Julio. And I just wanted to give a big thank you on behalf of AIA Baltimore and the Baltimore Architecture Foundation. I'm Kathleen Lane, Executive Director. Tremendous thanks to all of our presenters for the richness and breadth of your presentations and the dialogue. Thank you to Julio. Thank you to all of you for coming. And we hope now that you'll join us to continue the conversation at the Brass Tap, just down the hill at the Fitzgerald Building. We'll have some appetizers there. And we hope you'll join us and also join us again next Wednesday for the next lecture in the series. Thanks again.